It is April 11th, 2017, the full moon. My name is James Gesso, and this is ATTMind Radio. Hello everyone, welcome to another episode of ATTMind Radio. I am your host, as always, James W. Gesso. This is episode 45, and it is releasing on the full moon, April 11th, 2017. April has a couple fun holidays, one of which is April 20th, or 420, which is, I guess, kind of like International Ganja Smoking Day. And in particular relevance to today's episode, April 19th is what's called Bicycle Day. Bicycle Day is a yearly celebration around the world to commemorate the first ever intentional LSD trip back on April 19th in 1943, when Albert Hoffman, the creator or maybe discoverer of LSD, depending on how you want to look at it, when he had his first intentional LSD trip and began to ride his bicycle home. The story around Albert Hoffman's first LSD trip, the first ever intentional LSD trip, is quite a fun story, but I'm not going to get into it here. I do encourage you to Google Wikipedia it, however. That's because today's not about Albert Hoffman, but Albert Hoffman's problem child, as the title of his book suggests, is a primary contributor to the topic of the show today, which is a film about the relationship between Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert, now known as Baba Ram Dass. There have been many important figures in the development of psychedelic culture over the last many decades, but few are as infamous as Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert with their Harvard psilocybin project, with the their firing from Harvard, with the experiments at the Millbrook Estate, with Timothy Leary being claimed as the most dangerous man in America, and with Richard Alpert going through a incredible transformation into Baba Ram Dass and becoming and still being a very important and prolific spiritual teacher here in the Western world. So I'm very excited to have interviewed Gay Dillingham for this show. She is the director of the movie Dying to Know, which chronicles the friendship between Richard Alpert and Timothy Leary over the course of many years. Now, I'm not going to talk too much about the movie because we're going to get into that in the interview, but I am going to say and publicly admit that there was a time in my life, in my development as a psychedelic person and as an author on the psychedelic experience and whatever role I'm playing here as this podcast host, that I kind of had a bit of a hate on for Timothy Leary. I had read the perspective of certain people that had kind of vilified him, had made him out to be the enemy in a way, that it was his fault that that we were in the situation that we're in with the draconian prohibition laws against psychedelics and the complete banning of all scientific research over the course of 40 years or so until recently. And I have to admit that I was wrong. I was poorly informed, and I didn't realize how poorly informed I was. And I can't take back the words that I said in front of people when I had basically said that I felt upset with Timothy Leary and that I was even at some points, I think I'd even said I was disgusted by what his actions had done for the psychedelic culture. And yeah, I was youthful and I was really charged up, and I blamed him and I was wrong. And watching this film really showed me how incorrect I actually was and helped me kind of get off my high horse in a way. And you'll hear me talk about this in the interview. It not only got me off my high horse and put me into the humility that I needed to be in, but it really helped me learn how much I deeply care for the work that this man was doing and how important it was and how wrong I had gotten the whole thing. I mean, admittedly, I didn't even really read too much of Timothy Leary's stuff. It never really connected with me. I was more of a Terrence McKenna kind of guy. I really dug the Bard. I really enjoyed his somewhat nasally but oftentimes hypnotic and deeply poetic meanderings on philosophy and society. And even though there were many times that, and even still, that I have no idea what he's talking about sometimes, I'm really just romanticized with how beautiful his mind works. So I've always been more of a Terrence McKenna person, but since watching this film, I've gotten much more interested in the important work that that Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert were doing at that time. I had already been a pretty big fan of Baba Ram Dass, as some of you might already know. He wrote a book called Be Here Now. It's like a square blue book with like a chair on the front of it. And I read it at a very important time in my development as a person and in my spiritual journey. And it played a key role in sort of nudging me towards recognizing the larger spiritual potential of psychedelics, and even nudging me towards the possibility of transforming my life for the better, utilizing psychedelics, even though at that time in my life that I read the book, psychedelics were a primary contributor to what had kind of messed up my life, which had to do with irresponsible and reckless drug use. Before we get into this interview, real quick, I just want to thank my patrons out there on Patreon who are what makes this podcast possible. Thank you so much. There are a few of you that jumped into the higher pledge bracket and have really been contributing a significant amount, and that is Carl, Wes, Greg, Thomas, and Melanie. Thank you so much for making the effort and becoming my patrons. But to all of you out there who have been helping this podcast come together on the financial end of things and on the social end of things, just really couldn't do it without you. So thank you so much. For those of you listening, if you're not yet my patron on Patreon and you're really enjoying this show and you would like to give back, you can head over to jameswgesso.com/support and take a look at the few ways that you could support financially to the show, including Patreon. If you happen to show your support by pledging $4 or more before April 31st, you will get your name included on a special art card that I will be personally signing and addressing and sending out in the mail to you. There will also be some other cool print media, like some stickers and stuff. I'm getting really excited because slowly but surely it's starting to come together. The whole website is gonna get a really cool facelift, and the new logo, I guess like mascot for the podcast, is designed by Eduardo Kine, visionary artist. I'm just like, I'm so happy and excited to show it to you guys, but unfortunately you don't get to see it unless you're a patron, at least until the new podcast face, I guess, launches sometime in late May. The exact date is yet to be released. But if you do want to see it in advance, get involved, get some stickers and get your name on the card, well, jameswgesso.com/support to do that. Enough about the logistics that hold this podcast up. Here is the content that you have tuned in to bear witness to, my interview with Gay Dillingham here on ATTMind Radio. Enjoy. Gay Dillingham has co-founded and managed two environmental technology companies, Earthstone International and Growstone. Under the Richardson administration, she served 8 years on the Environmental Improvement Board, a regulatory board in charge of environmental management and consumer protection for the state of New Mexico. Under her tenure, the EIB spearheaded the passage of the most comprehensive regulations on greenhouse gases in the country. She was one of only 4 Americans who joined Governor Richardson as his energy advisor on a private mission to North Korea in December 2010. Many believe this small delegation helped avert what likely could have ended in the armed conflict or war. So I get like one little slip up in reading Gay, and it's like trying to catch all the balls. Gay is also an award-winning filmmaker who is behind the documentary Dying to Know. Narrated by Robert Redford, this film chronicles the journey and friendship of two of the most infamous men in modern psychedelic history, Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert, who is now known as Baba Ram Dass, which is why we have her on the show today. Welcome, Gay.
Hi, great to be with you.
So I'm really happy that we're now actually recording this interview after about 20 minutes of trying to sort it out on both sides of the conversation of making it work. So here we are. To start us off...
We can even connect here in cyberspace is a miracle to begin with. So
yeah, where are you right now, actually?
I'm in Santa Fe, New Mexico.
Oh, cool. And I'm in Kitchener, Ontario. Despite what the current administration might have to say, like they cannot stop us from traveling to each other, at least over cyberspace yet.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank God.
Yeah, but that's a different and much heavier topic, I think. So to start us off, please give us a synopsis of your film. Who are these two men and what did they do?
Well, Richard Alpert became Ram Dass and Timothy Leary stayed Timothy Leary. He since has passed, but these were two Harvard psychologists that in the early 60s worked with psychedelics, in this case psilocybin, with graduate students. And, one of the lines that we've used is, whether you knew these guys or not, they changed your life. Because much of what, I was born in 65, and they were Harvard between 60 and 63. And it was largely what kind of set off the 60s in terms of, you know, psychedelics being spawned into the wider culture. And Timothy sadly went to prison in many ways because he was too influential with the boomers, with the young people. And these young people are now 60, 70, 80 years old, which ironically we're having a new interesting wave of influence, right? So these two men were very close. They had a really interesting relationship, which I discovered over many years. Well, I discovered over doing this documentary. And that became the portal of the film for me, because maybe like you, I had only inherited caricatures of who these guys were. And really seeing and meeting them, Timothy on his deathbed, really fell in love with the guy. Because the person I knew before, I'd seen him once when I was in college. And at that point, I really saw more the showman. I didn't really see the man. And through seeing him through the eyes of Ram Dass was really quite profound for me, because I saw him through the lens of love instead of through the lens of judgment, which is generally how we consume in our culture. We consume media personalities and so forth. So I would posit that without these two guys, yes, eventually psychedelics, yes, eventually yoga in the East would have all come to America. But they really helped usher in because they were older, they had credibility, Timothy, the first time he took psychedelics, a psilocybin mushroom in Mexico, he said that he learned more in 4 hours than he had in 15 years as a psychologist. So he had felt he found the elixir. Right. And he really wanted to study these compounds. And so when he had the opportunity, when he was recruited, when he was at Berkeley and he was recruited to Harvard, and David McClelland at Harvard said, you can study anything you want. So, of course, Timothy wanted to study these psilocybin mushrooms. And at the time, Ram Dass, Richard Alpert at the time, was younger than Tim. And they teamed up as these two professors to do this work. And the way in which they got kicked out of Harvard, we can cover that now or later, but that's also a fascinating story. Because no one had been fired from Harvard. The last person that fired from Harvard was 100 years earlier. It was Ralph Waldo Emerson for basically saying you have direct access to God. And in many ways, these guys were saying, hey, these substances can give you that direct transcendental experience. And so Tim's contract had expired, so that's kind of how he left. But Richard was fired. And that's a whole other interesting story, which we could get to. But, I know that's kind of a long-winded way of answering your question, but the way I approached this film was not just the history and the biopic of a relationship or these two men, but how they had a very fresh relationship to death and rebirth as a psychological process, or even death at the end of the body. And I had lost a brother when I was 17. He was 20, who I adored. He was like the center of my life. And so at a young age, I kind of was maybe forced into, trying to wake up a little earlier than I normally would have. But, some of this medicine helped me in that grieving process. And I also read the Tibetan Book of the Dead at that time, and then found the Psychedelic Experience, which was a book that Leary and Alpert had written along with Ralph Metzner, based on the Tibetan Book of the Dead. So they take you through a psychedelic experience, psychedelic session, like following the bardos, etc. So you're probably aware of that book. So that all led me to this fascination with using psychedelics consciously as a way to practice death and rebirth as a psychological process. And we have very few tools in our culture to help us do that, which often comes with rites of passage and things like that, but we've kind of lost those traditions. So I really cared about it. It's a very contemporary film. As much as it's about history and these two guys, it's also very contemporary. It's about the issues we're all dying to talk about, but have a hard time talking about, i.e. death and drugs. But somehow people say they walk away very inspired with the film. So this leads me to my question to you, if I may.
Sure.
Where did the film leave you? How did you feel after you watched it?
Well, it left me in a good way. I was just generally intrigued, obviously, because I'm interested in psychedelic culture. And I know that you mentioned we could talk about why Leary got or how that whole like Harvard firing went, but I feel like I don't want to talk about too much of like what's in the movie, because I don't want people to get, I mean, like those awful trailers where after you watch them, you're like, I've seen the whole movie now. I don't want people to listen to this interview and be like, well, I could watch it, but I already know what's in it. Because it is actually quite a good watch. But I learned a lot that I didn't know otherwise, like such as the actual reason why they got fired, because I had this weird sort of amalgamation of the legend and then the anti-legend of like the mainstream narratives sort of like denouncement of Timothy Leary and Alpert and that whole movement. I had already been very interested in Baba Ram Dass because his book Be Here Now landed at a really important time in my life and was one of the contributing variables to why I chose to move towards using psychedelics to actually resolve and come to terms with leftover psychological damage from drug abuse, actually. Mm-hmm. And so I was already on sort of like on the tip of him being awesome. But mm-hmm. I had this I almost had this hate on for Timothy Leary in a way, because I was like, this is the clown that, you know, like shook the cage too much, and he's the one that pissed everyone off and caused this whole criminalization thing to happen. Like, he's kind of behind the Inquisition in a way, accidentally, as sort mm-hmm. of the poster child for who they were going up against. Now, over time, I did learn that actually wasn't the case. But in watching the documentary, I learned so much about who he was as a person, and or feel like I learned a lot about who he was as a person and sort of where he was coming from in regards to how he engaged that whole process and like some really cool things and interesting things that happened to him, like his association to the Weather Underground and the Black Panthers, and like, yeah, like hiding as like an international, I don't know the word I'm looking for, but basically hiding from the American government and
fugitive.
That's the word I'm looking for. And I actually, by the end of the film, I felt ashamed of having judged him so harshly. Like, I felt not like a negative shame. I don't really self-deprecate in that way, but it's like a healthy shame that helped me align with the reality of how I felt. And when, I mean, like, not to ruin the ending of the movie or anything, but, you know, Timothy Leary does die.
So at the end,
I almost felt like I was grieving a little bit. Like, I it's not that I felt like I was grieving. I was grieving a little bit and I was sad. I was like, I feel like I'm just learning now that I had an uncle I never knew, and I'll never really get a chance to know him, and I've spent so much of my life judging him harshly that I miss the man who he truly was. And yeah, it was really actually a very important experience for me to like reconcile my relationship with Tim Leary. So thank you for that.
Well, thank you for saying that. That was well said, because you're not the only one that basically took on the opinion that it was his fault. He really called too much attention to the psychedelics, and what was really important for me in the whole process was, he was scapegoated. You know, I went to enough conferences with enough people starting their conversations or their talks by saying, if it weren't for Tim Leary having ruined it, we could have kept the research going for 35 years. But I really found that, hang on one second. Oh, sorry, just a second. Okay. That we often do that. We often scapegoat. And having scapegoated Timothy Leary was convenient. And he played into that. So I'm not completely, he does have some responsibility in that. But what I really cared about was telling the human story, his story. And like I said earlier, seeing it through the lens of Ram Dass, which is through a lens of love instead of judgment. And that our movement doesn't serve us, our movement, when we scapegoat each other. And there's no way this could have happened under one man's fault, you know.
Of course, yeah.
And it, the mainstream, it benefited to scapegoat him. And we bought into that, which I think is not, doesn't serve. And he actually did suffer. And that's what most people don't remember. They don't even remember he spent almost 4 years in prison, right? And 2.5 years in solitary confinement. Because he always, you know, followed Marshall McLuhan's advice, keep a smile on your face and, keep the movement positive and things like that. And the other line that many people kind of follow is, oh, he just fried himself on LSD or whatever. And one of the things Andy Weil says to me, not in the film, it's some of the other material I had to cut out, but nope, Tim was all present. He was there. He had other problems, but he did not fry his brain on LSD. I mean, that was not the issue. Joanna Harcourt Smith, who was with him during the prison period, also said that, you know, and this is talked about in the film, that, you know, what they were doing to him when he was in prison, which really affected him as well. So, I think telling the human story and having compassion for each other and is going to get us a lot further along than the sort of overall agenda that tends to come through our media culture right now, which is let's tear each other down as much as possible and judge. So, seeing the whole span of the life, you know, both he and Ram Dass, because Ram Dass then went through a stroke and only had 10% chance of survival, and how he came through that and how much his wisdom grew because of that fierce grace, he called it, of the stroke. Anyway, so I probably said enough there, but thank you for bringing that up, because I also had that, you know, that opinion and that thought until I really got to know him. And he was on his deathbed. Tim was so vulnerable and still intelligent and funny as hell. And very human. So, and he really let me see that, let me in. So that was nice.
You mentioned, I just want to make the comment that this premise, this angle that you went about doing the documentary, looking at it from like the lens of love, and there really is an underlying vein of a friendship And it's like, it's the story of Timothy Leary and Richard Alpert, and it's the story of like their roles in the larger sort of first wave psychedelic renaissance and all this stuff. But on the undertone throughout the entire thing is this like deep vein of friendship between these two men, and what this friendship both achieved positively and negatively, mm-hmm. and what that all looks like in the end when reflecting back. There's a, I know for me, I'm watching it and I'm just feeling a lot of gratitude and almost like a some sadness too, because it made me think of a couple men in my life who have been very, very close friends, and we've journeyed the nether realms together, and they're not in my life anymore. We all live in different parts of the world now, but it really helped me appreciate and feel a bit of like poignant and important sadness around that. You mentioned that you got to interview Timothy Leary at the end of his life before he died. And I think some of the most valuable content that I, for me, the most deeply hitting content that I saw in the movie was actually an interview, or like a recording of just Timothy and Baba Ram Dass talking about life, where they're at in the old days. Was that something that you recorded with them?
Yeah. So I started that 1995. Tim had announced he was dying in 95. And having dinner with a few people that were also kind of filmmakers. And we asked ourselves, what could we do? This is a historical moment. And so Andrew Ungerleiter came up with the idea, let's bring Ram Dass down from the Bay Area and put him together with Tim. See, I wouldn't have thought of that because I didn't understand their relationship at that point. It was all a very spontaneous thing. And the other ironic thing was we decided I would direct it. And I was the youngest one at the table, the only one that didn't live through the Harvard era, right? Yeah. So that was another interesting, you know. But I also made a film. Now I realize I made a film that a baby boomer wouldn't have made. But yet almost every boomer that's seen it has said, this is a real legacy film. You know, you really captured it. Maybe I was able to capture it because I wasn't living through it at the time. But it's about a lot more than just the 60s. And so we started in 95 in that conversation in Tim's living room is really the bones, the thread of the film. And, you know, what started as a conversation, I'm using this film as a conversation to keep talking about psychedelics and death and whatever we need to talk about. So we've been in 80 cities theatrically, which is kind of remarkable for a little documentary without a big studio budget behind it. And most of those cities I've either been able to go and facilitate the conversation, or we invite a lot of really interesting people in that intersect the themes of the film, whether it's end-of-life hospice, psychedelics. In New York, the guys at NYU that have done the research that just was published recently in New York Times and various great journals, Stephen Ross, Anthony Bosis, these guys came out and spoke after the film in New York and different cities. We just bring out different people and engage the audience. And like I said, talk about things we're dying to talk about. And it really gives me a lot of, it just fills my heart when I see an 18-year-old sitting next to an 80-year-old having these really juicy, beautiful, real meaningful conversations, right? And so, yeah, it's now available. Well, we'll talk about that later, but we do have this campaign. I've kind of done our own think for yourself distribution strategy, which has driven some people crazy because they're like, why isn't it available yet? But driving people, you know, encouraging people into a theater is a ritualized space. It is a
completely
dark,
agree.
Intentional. You turn your phones off, you're present, you're being here now. And you're with other people writing a story of emotion and time, and then to have a conversation with people you wouldn't normally because they're not sitting in your living room. So, you know, we have a culture now of our small devices, which is also a wonderful thing, but it's different. If I'm watching a film on a computer and the phone rings or people come through, you're not completely around that campfire, absorbing the... So I call theater our modern campfire, potentially the potential to be our modern campfire, where we tell our stories and look at the past, contemplate our futures. And so we've really taken our time. It's been almost 2 years doing this theatrical thing. But now we just launched an Indiegogo campaign which is weird too. I mean, not weird, but doing it at the back end instead of the front end. I didn't seem to have time until now. But it allows us to do a preview stream for people. And it's all tax deductible. So you can get a stream, a DVD, these other cool rewards. And then eventually it'll also be available, you know, on all the platforms. But I do encourage people to, you know, use it as a conversation piece.
Mm-hmm. I totally agree about this. The importance of ritualizing the enjoyment of something, whether it be just like an entertainment value, like showing of some sort of movie, or if it's like a sort of like a deeply poignant documentary. I actually had the opportunity to do a large screening for Neurons to Nirvana a few years ago.
Oh.
And it was like the biggest psychedelic event I think that had ever been, I know, was ever in Calgary, Alberta. And the whole premise of the crew of us that threw this together was like, let's create an intentional space, show this documentary, and then we had a gathering afterwards that was like psytrance music, and people, it was like a double feature. People could get tickets to go to both, because afterwards we're like, now we want to put people in a place of like total relaxed recreational space to just talk and like just focus everything around psychedelic culture. And it went over really well. So having the opportunity to see documentaries like this in the cinema, I think are really important. And thank you. I actually took this very same mentality to when I watched your film, because I messaged about four other friends and said, look, I've got this amazing opportunity to watch a screener for this film, and I feel like I'd really like to share that experience with you guys. Are you open to it? And they said, yeah. So we all sat together and we watched the film together. Some of them are already savvy to psychedelics. Some of them aren't, or I don't actually know about one of them, but none of them were really super familiar with the story. I was the most familiar. And like I said before, I had a bunch of assumptions and misguided caricatures in my mind rather than these real people. And afterwards I asked, I was like, okay, so I'm going to have the opportunity to interview the director. What, if anything, do you feel like you'd like to ask? And one of the questions came up like, well, what else has she done? And we looked into it, and I'm gonna read a little bit here, that your first film is the WIPP Trail. And it casts
Waste Isolation Pilot Plant.
Perfect. And it casts a critical eye on the U.S.'s first and still world's only underground nuclear waste repository, which came a community organizing tool and even aired on PBS nationally, followed by a panel discussion. And another one of your films, My Body Belongs to Me, which is a children's proactive educational program on sexual abuse, earned an award at the American Film Festival. And so as somebody who has found mainstream success as a filmmaker, this is the question that came up amongst us. What was it that led you to dedicate 19 years of your life to making a documentary about one of the most fringe and stigmatized topics in our modern world? And I mean, you've kind of partially answered this intermittently throughout the interview so far, but as an added question, did you face any stigma from other people or the industry when you chose to move forward on making this film?
Well, I really like that question. Thank you. I mean, I would flip it upside down, which is the psychedelics are what informed me as a human being in my life. Therefore, it gave me the passion to look more deeply and take responsibility for nuclear waste, for sexual abuse, even though I wasn't having it. What is happening in the fabric of my culture? And all of that sprung out of my whatever wisdom I had gained from this medicine. So when I was running the Environmental Improvement Board, there was a lot of, I had to be very careful. So I had started the film in 95, shot in 96. Ram Dass had his stroke in 97. I lost my father. Other things were happening. I was trying to launch these environmental tech businesses, which is also how do you do well by doing good. So we take recycled glass out of a landfill instead of strip mining our mountains, and we make non-toxic products and all kinds of things. So that was a whole, you know, foray into business. It's like, oh, okay. So I've done government, business, international relations, because it's wherever consciousness takes you where you can apply yourself and make a difference. But when I was doing the environmental work, you know, yeah, I had a lot of judgment. So I realized then consciously, and I didn't have the time either. I couldn't finish the film, right? So, and if I would have been working on it, I was already labeled by this administration that had kicked me out, a known environmentalist, right? Like, that's a bad thing.
I know, it's almost like, yeah, like synonymous with terrorist. Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
It's the Environmental Improvement Board. We're supposed to be improving. But anyway, so while I was doing that work, I really kind of had to try to put on the conservative, at least not give them any more ammunition, if you will. And, you know, I grew up on a ranch in Oklahoma, and I was also, our family, you know, in and out was involved with oil and gas. So I really understood the language to be able to do these greenhouse gas regulations. And so I feel like I've really been on both sides of many issues. And it's one of the reasons I think in some ways can be more effective because I speak the language. But yeah, I very consciously realized I couldn't finish the film there, nor did I have the time. But when Richardson left, because he was termed out after 8 years, and you know, he was the kind of leader that understood. He was DOE secretary, Department of Energy secretary. He was UN ambassador to the United Nations. He understood the relationship of our energy policy to security. So that's why we were doing these regs in the first place in New Mexico. And then the current governor is pretty much in the back pocket of extractive industries. I mean, that's really where her supporters come from. So it was 12:01 midnight when she came into office and she fired our whole board. And so then I had time and the wherewithal to go deeper in my own meditation around, why do we have all the information out there on these existential threats like climate change and nuclear weapons, and we can't seem to do anything about it? And after a lot of contemplation, I came, and this footage kept coming back and haunting me. This footage I'd started in 95 and 96, right? Now we're at 2010, because I wasn't making film all those years. I wasn't a filmmaker during that period. But when I started answering that question, this footage kept coming back to me. The answer for me was, because we can't answer these questions and get momentum and movement, because we don't see ourselves in the cycle of life and death, which is where nature lives. We don't have that death rebirth process part of our culture. And until we can naturalize our own mortality and our own death, we can't really deal with these existential threats. So for me, it was my sneaky little way of another strategy to deal with these things. And now I feel like, you know, yes, we have an environment. We don't really know where we're heading politically. In some ways, I'm not surprised that we're here. It was only 13% of voting of our eligible voters that put Trump in office. And I've done a lot of dream work, Jungian dream work, which is really kind of my key navigation, aside from medicines at certain times in my life. But dreams have really been very important for me. And what did I want to say there? The shadow has been in our culture seething, and we haven't been really integrating it. And so my feeling is that this election really made visible the shadow, so that we have the opportunity now to integrate it, because you can't integrate if it's in the shadows, if you know what I mean. So I have some hope that this crisis can be a birth culturally for us. I'm also afraid of how ugly and messy it's going to get in the meantime. And can the planet, you know, take this many steps backward? I mean, can the environmental consequences? But I'm also very heartened by the spontaneous response from people, whether it was the Women's March, today it's the, you know, the sit-ins on the immigration law at the airports. I mean, humans are a problem-solving species, and at heart, in deep down, we're empathic. That's who we are. It's the power and greed and other things that get in the way. And if we truly had a representational democracy where we engaged, I think we'll be fine. And I think that's our growing pains right now. So anyway, I kind of got off topic here, but you know, I don't know. I don't know what we have to lose. I mean, this is not a dress rehearsal, so I'm ready to say what I need to say, I suppose. And there was a reason for a while I didn't finish the film, because I was doing this other work, and I think it would have gotten in the way. But you know, I care about this. These are the kind of topics I'm willing to go out on the edge for, the line for.
Mm-hmm. I really appreciate you taking a second to give your perspective on sort of the unfortunate, but hopefully in the long vision, very fortunate exposure of the reality of the American cultural and political paradigm through the rise and the presidency of Donald Trump. I was actually thinking I was going to ask you that as a little segue question, so I'm glad you answered it.
Well, I'll say one more thing, because one of the sort of ills that we're suffering from is distraction, and that we're, you know, when I made this film, I didn't think the be here now part was going to be as important. I thought think for yourself, question, you know, some of the other pieces were more pertinent, but the be here now is so hard for us because, you know, everything is designed to distract us, the commercialism, everything. And until we get really deep and slow and thoughtful, we're not going to get through this. And I think that's what people are realizing, the quality of life. And it's also why I tried to, instead of dealing with politics or nukes or whatever, I wanted to get into a deeper, more personal, because the more personal we go, the more political and collective we can be. And I find that life happens in relationship and relationally. And that's also what these two guys show us, you know, how they affected each other, and then for how that relationship between them affected an entire generation, an entire culture. And we live in a culture that kind of glorifies the individual, but in fact, we really are all impacted and affected, and we do things in groups and relationally, generally. And that's a very beautiful, powerful thing. And anyway, I'm a little long-winded there, sorry.
No, that was great, thank you. I really appreciate what you said there about going back and reflecting. So we've got all these problems, and we know what the problems are, but we just can't seem to solve it. Like, why the hell can't we seem to solve this problem? And getting to a point where you realized, or you came to contemplate on how, I thought of the Einstein quote that's something to the nature of you cannot solve a problem from the same level of consciousness that you created it. And definitely when we look at ourselves as a species and everything in the human world, it's all constructed out of relationships, and the ability to anticipate, and good relationships come with that ability to emotionally anticipate and resonate with each other. And all of our problems, regardless of what's happening on the surface, whether it be surface on like the smaller scale of our own lives or surface on the largest scale of the sort of cumulative expression of all our little micro interactions in regards to world politics. Mm-hmm. If you just ask, like, whatever the problem is, like, but what's underneath that? But yeah. What's underneath that? But what's underneath that? Eventually, all the problems will boil down to some very core and somewhat infantile need or boundary or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the most core issues that we have is our fear of death. And thus, from that fear and a lack of sort of cultural support, we have Stephen Jenkinson calls a death-phobic culture. And so because of that, it's like we're so blind to the reality that, like, hey, death happens, that it's like we make decisions that totally disregard that death can happen, and that we might be imposing death upon others with our actions by a figurative death or a literal death in regards to how much life will there be if we nuke the planet. And so psychedelics are definitely a means to just, without having to ask, just be shown what's deeper, what's deeper, what's deeper, mm-hmm. what's deeper, until you get to that depth of the dying experience, at least as it's perceived within a psychedelic experience, mm-hmm. and then coming back from there and contemplating these problems now from a different state of consciousness, because you've gone that deep.
Yeah, and you know, and I was fortunate enough, a younger part of my life, to live with different tribal native peoples and see that it's very different and incorporated very differently. There's other avenues. It could be ritual and tribal. It could be like my dream world helps me kind of get through that fear place, because dreams are kind of designed in a way that we often have the set and setting what the dream's about. We go through the action of the dream, and then we bump up against our place in our psyche that's the edge, which is the fear. And that's where we stop, because we don't have a lot of practice moving through the fear, because the fear holds us. But when you move through that, whether it's being eaten by an animal in a dream or whatever, or falling off a cliff, you actually don't die. It just transforms into something else. And it's usually much more revelatory on the other side of whatever moving through that fear is. And that's what Carl Jung called the lysis, which is the solution, where often you wake up in early, you know, in morning time dreams, and you think, oh, I got the answer to some question, or because you've broken through some edge or some fear you had, and came to the lysis or the solution. So there's different ways to practice this. Psychedelics is one really great way. And I'm really glad this research is coming out now at Johns Hopkins and NYU and UCLA. And we need to support this. You know, it's mostly all been funded privately. And we need to start asking our government to put, you know, funds into these things that can really heal us, and to do it consciously, not just like go take a bunch of whatever without thinking about your set and setting. And sadly, because we don't, it's not very, I think a lot of people are, but there's enough that aren't, and there's a lot of casualties to that. You mentioned something about, because my mom also, I started going to AA meetings and NA meetings and stuff with her when I was young, because she was alcoholic during my parents' divorce, which was about 14 to 17 for me, years old. And when she, when my brother died, which, you know, losing your own child for her, you know, I don't know that it gets worse than that, but she finally realized she couldn't drink her pain away. So she quit drinking and started healing. And she started taking me to all these AA meetings and different meetings. And so I got to learn and at an early age, the other side of all kinds of substance, you know, and we don't really have a lot of that education in our society either. So you mentioned something earlier, and I appreciated that, your own healing through drug issues. And I don't know if you wanted to say more about that, but, you know, it's interesting, this film, even though it chronicles two of the icons of the psychedelic movement, it's not really a pro or con film. I'm not, you know, saying you have to do it this way. There's a lot of people that watch this film that have never taken a psychedelic and get a lot out of it. In some ways, they say the film is like taking a psychedelic. It's a journey of sorts. And because my mom's been my biggest advocate and also critic, because she's watched every single version of this film since the time began. And she's 85 now. And I show it to her friends. And I've gone to old folks' homes and shown the film there. That's not what they call them anymore, old folks' homes, which is, you know, a sad term. But I'm kind of amazed at consciousness is consciousness, and you can get there through many routes. And I also like that this film has opened up a lot of people that have never done psychedelics to say, oh, I really want to try that. It doesn't seem as scary or as terrible as, you know, whatever the impressions were before. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I'm taking so long to answer questions. I'm just kind of a little long-winded today.
No, it's okay. I really appreciate taking the time to go deep on your thoughts. I also appreciated that your film wasn't pro-psychedelic. It was like pro-thoughtfulness and like pro-connection and pro-intrigue a little bit, rather than...
Psychedelics are going to fix everything.
Yeah, sorry. I'm just having a brief editing glitch that I'll fix later, hopefully. Yeah, because the psychedelic experience itself isn't even about the psychedelic experience necessarily. It's about every other aspect of life. And so if we really want to talk about the most valuable aspects of the psychedelic experience, we need to talk about what it showed us about being alive, and in what it means to be alive, what it means to die. And obviously we've mentioned many times death has been a big part of the film, talking about death. And you actually structured the film into these segments, and the segments were structured as birth, death, life, and soul. Why did you choose to structure it under those sort of sub-themes?
Well, I knew I wanted to, you know, I wanted to have the ability to be nonlinear. And the earlier times I got to have with Native American people, I learned vision questing. And when you build a medicine wheel, you come in through the east, which is birth, and the south is usually life. Different traditions have different ways in which they structure that. But for the most part, I wanted to orient the viewer through these big themes, because that is really the structure of how I understand things. And the mandala underneath it, the square part of the mandala, was from Be Here Now. So I pulled that out, and then I superimposed the medicine wheel, kind of life, death, birth, and soul on top of that. And the first time I had somebody execute or animate that, it was very computerized and synthetic, and that didn't feel right. So then I found this beautiful illustrator, Dustin Lindblatt, and she drew a lot of the natural elements in that mandala, and then we animated it, which felt really good and more appropriate to the topic. From the very beginning, I always had that kind of structure in my head, and also to make it feel also nonlinear, like you can go into any of those portals as a theme.
Which is definitely also a characteristic of the psychedelic experience. Multiple layers of timelines existing simultaneously, arranged by feeling, tone, and topic.
Yes. Yeah.
So I want to see if I can pick your brain for something that I otherwise wouldn't know, which is to say, you followed and analyzed and investigated a 30-plus year friendship of two incredibly influential, complex, and important people, and your movie is about 2 hours long. So in storytelling, there's a lot of discernment that needs to happen, and that discernment sometimes is because certain things that you want to have included, you can't include because of time. Other times you can't include because they don't fit in the storyline. What was it that, this is kind of a two-part question. So the first one is, were there any things that you really wanted to include in the documentary, but you couldn't because of, say, time, or it just didn't fit enough? And the second part of this question, is there anything in the documentary that just like didn't connect at all, but you learned about in the process and you just think is really interesting and just weren't able to get it into the documentary?
Well, that's a very good question. That's probably why it took so long, is to take that much story and put it into, and I will say it's 92 minutes, not right. 2 hours. I really pride myself on getting it close to, you know, the hour and a half, because that was really hard. And these two had a 35-year relationship. The footage that I have in the film is 80 years from beginning to end. The interviews alone are about 60 years. And there's a lot I couldn't fit in. On the other hand, when I kept coming back to the discipline or the portal of their relationship, that's what had to infuse what I left out or what I kept in. There was a few things I went ahead and put in kind of more as background, like is a psychedelic toxic? What is the actual medicine or the science behind something? So Andy Weil, Dr. Andrew Weil, the integrative medicine doctor, opined on that a few times. But he intersected the story because he was the one that in many ways wrote the investigative journalism that got Richard Alpert fired from Harvard. And it took them a long time to really make up and be friends, and that was a journey. And I also was very involved with Andy at the same time I was shooting this beginning footage with Leary and Alpert in 95, because we produced Andy Weil's first two PBS shows that helped launch his career. And it took me a long time to realize he was the one that had outed Richard Alpert. I didn't know that when I was working with all of them at the same time. And many people didn't know that. So, you know, there was a lot that, well, let me also just, at some point I want to tell you more about the team that made this happen, but one of the real gifts was Robert Redford coming in and helping, not just with the narration, because he did the narration, but he asked if I wanted his notes, and he graciously, it wasn't like he was forcing anything. And we'd had a few conversations on the phone about the film, which were very helpful. And he'd say things in a way that were really made me contemplate, and I'd have to digest and dream on it. And then, oh, I know what he meant. And then I could deal with the edit a little better. But at the very end, when I was really having a hard time cutting out the extra fat to keep condensing it down, he said, "Do you want my notes?" So he came over. We both had transcripts, sat in my little video editing studio. This master storyteller, right, gives me almost, you know, 4.5 hours of his time. And we go through the entire thing and had really incredible conversation about everything you can imagine. But he helped me really refine, restructure the end, get rid of things that weren't serving the story. So I've had really, I'm so blessed with wise people in my life, including his guidance. And the stories that we did have to leave on the cutting room floor and the highlight reels, some of that footage is on our Facebook page, you know, extras, but I'm going to do a whole kind of extra DVD and or, you know, extra, you know, the highlight interviews from all these people. And hopefully that'll be out very soon. So just go to our website and sign up there, and then you'll get all this extra material eventually. Also, which is dyingtoknowmovie.com. And, you know, I actually feel pretty good about the film. There's no part that makes me feel like, oh God, why is that still in there? Or why couldn't I leave this other section in there? You know, I could always say I wish I had more money to do things.
We
really
could all say that.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
But at the end of the day, you know, like the animation, some of the animation in there I got from some Italian animation students of Albert Hoffman's bicycle ride. It was beautiful, right? That was beautiful.
Yeah, footage. It was. It was great.
So it really did take a village and a lot of really incredible people. You can imagine over 20 years how many people came in and out of helping do this documentary. And particularly, I want to say Neurons to Nirvana, Giancarlo Canavasio was the executive producer on Neurons to Nirvana. And he was also part of our team that helped, as one of the funders. So thanks immensely to him. And then David Leitch was a very seminal storyteller, editor. And really, you know, like you said, taking really three full stories, because you've got Leary's bio in life, you've got Richard Alpert Ram Dass's, then you've got the relationship, then you have the story of psychedelics, then you have the other story and theme of end of life and death with dignity and that whole theme. So there was a lot of ways that we had to integrate the story, and most people say it's pretty integrative, which is good. That's why it also took time. And because I didn't have some, you know, corporate funder breathing over my shoulder, I could take time to figure out how to do it, right? And there was a time where I was really kind of hard on myself because I didn't have the time to finish it. I was doing the launching a business and all the other stuff. And I went to Ram Dass at one point. I said, I just can't seem to get the time to finish this. Because to finish something like this, it takes a lot of time. It like 24/7. You just get consumed. And so I said, I think I'm going to have to hand it off because I can't. I don't have the time. And he went into his contemplative Be Here Now place, and he had his stroke. This was about 2023 or something, or six or something. And he says, gets quiet, and he opens his eyes and looks at me and says, "You'll finish it one day." And ironically, by the time I finished it, I think the culture of the zeitgeist was more ready to hear it. In some ways, maybe it worked out better. And it was a better film because it took me so long. And I had to grow up, too. I mean, the film made me as much as I made this film. And I needed to learn and hear all these stories and lessons. And the dance of complementarity. I mean, I think that Leary and Alpert, for me at least, represented what was kind of autobiographical going on in my own head. Sort of this archetype of the mind speaking with the archetype of the heart in this beautiful dance. That's why I kept using the yin-yang in the film. And I thought if that dialogue goes on inside of me, like, oh, you know, I've got the believer, like Ram Dass, of course we go on. And the other side, which is, well, you die, you know, when you're dead, you're dead. The scientist, you know, the doubter, I think it's natural to have all those voices. And the beauty is we are all dying to know. We don't know till we die. And there's a mystery, and I'm probably the church of mystery if I was to awe and mystery if I was to have to define any particular place. But I mean, stories that were left out. Oh God, there's so many. Do you have any particular character? And I'll pull a story out from, what do you want to know more about?
All right, here's a story I could ask you about. There was a sort of a famed rivalry between the Millbrook estate, the scientists, the intellectuals, the people that were like highly fine-tuning everything to try to achieve something in particular, Leary, Alpert. And then there was the Ken Kesey, Merry Pranksters, which I think on some level, I think probably Timothy Leary took the public blame for a lot of the problems that were caused by the Merry Pranksters, more so than they were caused by Leary and Alpert's rather diligent setting constructions and intellectual approach.
Right.
But there's a famed rivalry between these two camps. Did you learn of any interesting stories about their dynamic?
Well, first, I just want to rewind a little bit to the background. Ken Kesey, and what we do also cover in the film, but this could be a whole nother film, which is the early military use of psychedelics, and particularly LSD, and trying for mind control, MK Ultra, which is mind control, ultra mind control. And this is a pretty well-known program inside the CIA now. But Ken Kesey got a hold of his first psychedelics while he was working in a mental hospital. So his access didn't come through, you know, the Harvard East Coast. And if you really want to blame somebody, or not blame, but, you know, you're right. A lot of the kind of proliferation, if you will, the acid tests and just giving it to hundreds of people at once, was really through the West Coast and Ken Kesey, Merry Pranksters, and that they had their role. So what more was there? I think more is made of that than there may have been. What I had understood and heard from Tim, when they came, he was sick, and so there wasn't a big hello welcome party and all of this when the Merry Pranksters drove up into the Millbrook driveway. He literally had a flu or cold or something, and there was a difference, the West Coast to the East Coast, there always has been. And that footage, there was some footage in my film. When I had an editor working with me when I didn't have enough time and I kind of handed it off, they put some footage in there because Ken Kesey was kind of honoring Tim, and they were kind of doing their last goodbyes over a Skype and toasting each other and all kinds of things. And it was cool. It was beautiful footage. They adored each other at the end of their lives. But that didn't serve the portal of the story I was trying to tell, so I had to take it out. Because then that was Ken and Tim, right? That was a different... There are so many rabbit holes, beautiful rabbit holes to go down, that what I'd eventually like to do is just have a lot of access to information through our website. If you're interested in more on this, you know, here's a book, here's an interview, here's a, you know, to keep going down all those beautiful rabbit holes wherever we want to go into more story. The East Coast, West Coast, I think that cultural dynamic still goes on, don't you?
I have lived it. I live on the east side now. My family's from Newfoundland, which is about as east coast as you can get in Canada. And I sort of like found my own and my heart and soul on the bass music dance floors of the West Coast. So I understand the divide all too viscerally, unfortunately.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fortunately and unfortunately.
Well, that's the dance of duality too, you know, the...
Yeah. So one last question I have for you before inviting you to list off anyone you feel like you'd like to acknowledge with their help on the film, and then to give again the links, the digital portals for supporting your film. The last question is, if you could sum up the greatest lesson or revelation that you had through the course of producing this film personally in your own life, what would it be?
Well, I have thought about that recently, and I made a tote bag out of it. I thought if I was to mash up these two guys in their bumper sticker wisdom, because they've taken all their wisdom and put it into a bumper sticker, and then if I was to mash those two guys together, that's pretty much where this comes from. So it would be here now and think for yourself with unconditional love. Because if I just think about that and try to practice and live that, it covers pretty much all of it, and it's a good meditation for me, at least. Is that kind of what you were?
That's beautiful. Yeah, that's beautiful. So, if you'd like to list off some of the other people to acknowledge, because, like you said, it takes a tribe to build a film. Or I'm paraphrasing you, but you mentioned tribe. Yeah. If you want to list off some of those important people, and then end us off with how we can get a hold of Dying to Know and possibly watch some of your other films as well.
Oh God, such a long list. I'm going to start with, I already mentioned Giancarlo and Tao, Dal LaMagna, Andrew Ungerleiter. These are now funders, friends, supporters, Rena, Shulsky David and Sammy David, Carlin Celeste. These are all, you know, supporters and people that put money into this. Early on, before I even, you know, I think had the confidence. Because there was a lot of times I thought, what am I doing? Hasn't this story been told? You know, I had those dark moments. And now I know the story hadn't been told. But these were the people that helped push me through Chuck Blitz, push me through Dasima, who's close to Ram Dass. Ram Dass helped keep the wind in the sails. And then on the editor side, I already mentioned David Leitch, Ethan Bohm, Steve Postel, brilliant sound composer, musician. He did most of the soundtrack. Jackson Brown and Krishna Das lent music to it. Jai Utal, Alan Kozlowski and Sandra Hay were my associate producers. They were there at the very beginning, the first conversation. Helped shoot that first dialogue. Let's see. I already mentioned. You'll cut this part out.
No, there's no cuts.
Oh, there's no cuts?
There's no cuts.
Oh,
it's all like real human dynamic here.
There's a lot of good... And Michael Donnelly has been, you know, came in post-production and helped me through this whole unique distribution strategy. And then theatrically, Richard Abramowitz at Abramorama. Zach Leary. How could I forget Zach? Zach's been doing the social media for, you know, he's in the film. He's Tim's adopted son. He's as close to the offspring of Tim Leary and Richard Alpert Ram Dass as you can get, because he's had... you know, 17 years with Tim before he died. And then, so he was his adopted son. And Zach's been great. So, and he has a podcast as well. So he's been great. Penelope Place, one of my early friends and associate producers. Boy, my mom, my 85-year-old mom, who's, you know, my parents gave me so much freedom and support and love, even when life was hard. So, you know, and a lot of very, very wise friends, Zuleika and Colleen, that just, I'm just so lucky. I mean, I live in a place like Santa Fe where people are, have really been on the journey. And I've had a lot of wise friends that have guided me over the years, that everything filters into, you know, life lessons. And now I'm trying out a new project, which is related, and kind of a big one. So maybe we'll talk about that in the next podcast.
Yeah, that sounds good. So what are the links, portals, Twitter handles, website URLs? How do we get to watch Dying to Know? And how can we learn more about what you're doing?
Well, right now you can actually get a stream of the film, and I think there's only 7 days left in our Indiegogo campaign. So dyingtoknowmovie.com is one place you can go to get everything. You can get to our Facebook, which is Dying to Know Movie. You can get to Twitter. You can, I do have an Instagram, but I'm kind of hit or miss sometimes with my, but dyingtoknowmovie.com, I'd go to the Indiegogo campaign and share that. I mean, if you've seen the film, you can share it with people that you think would want to see the film. A lot of people have told me, oh, they want to see it or share it with somebody who's maybe going through their own, helping a loved one through the midwifing their death, or going through their own challenging health problems, or just something to inspire them. So, yeah, the Indiegogo campaign, do that now because it's going to be over, and then we can't do any digital for a period of time. So I'm not sure exactly when it's going to be out on the other platforms, like, you know, Netflix and Hulu and Apple and iTunes, all that.
Unfortunately,
so get this thing now.
Yeah, unfortunately, I don't think this interview is going to come up by then. So I'm sorry to all the listeners that's going to miss out, but definitely still.
Okay, so let me restate that then.
Yeah.
Huh. How do we do this?
Well, what was the name of the link again?
Well, it's dyingtoknowmovie.com. And we also have Gather. We have theatrical on demand where you can apply to have it in a theater near you. And if you gather a minimum number and pre-sell a minimum number of tickets, you show it there in your town or your theater or whatever. That's called Gather. And that'll be on our website as well. So just kind of connect through our website is probably the best idea, because since the Indiegogo is going to be over. And Facebook, Dying to Know Movie is the name of that. Is that right? Shit.
I'll make sure that the appropriate links.
It might be the title. The full title is Dying to Know Ram Dass and Timothy Leary.
Right. So I'll make sure all of those links are available in the show notes for the listeners, which will be at jameswjesso.com. Which I repeat multiple times throughout the course of the podcast, intro and outro, the name of that URL. So it's like if you're looking for the links and you can't remember them later, they will be boldly available on the website as well.
Okay. Who knows? Maybe we'll be able to extend the campaign. So who knows? When do you think it'll be up?
I don't know how to answer that question, because I can put it up in the queue, but the podcast still only come out every other week. So it would, and the next one's already set to go. So we're looking at at least 3, if not 6 weeks from now before the podcast is out.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Sorry.
Okay. I guess I should have known that, so I didn't try to promote the... Oh, well, you can cut that out.
No, there's no cuts. It's all real human stuff. I know. It must be like heresy for you as a filmmaker to say that.
All right. It's reality podcasting.
Non-fiction podcasting. If it was reality, I'd be saying something mean to you right now, and then I'd be talking to the other camera being like, yeah, I just can't believe her. So it's like, oh, God, she's so selfish. It's like it's all about her. Anyways, okay, on that note, thank you so much for giving us your time today, and for the nearly 20 years you put into making this incredible documentary.
I really enjoyed talking to you, James, and I love your podcast. So keep it up.
Thank you. Bye.
Keep up the medicine. Adios. Bye.
Okay, thank you for tuning in. I have to say that I was tickled pink at the end of that episode, because I really liked talking to Gay. She was a very, very interesting woman, and I found a rapport with her very quickly. It was like I had just met up with a good friend who I hadn't seen in years, and it really touched my day in a positive way following after that. So I hope that you caught that that good rapport in the interview, and that you caught a little bit of the good vibes that conversation brought me into my life. And if you did catch those good vibes and you'd like to pay it forward, one of the best ways you could do that is totally going and checking out Dying to Know. The documentary is absolutely wonderful to watch. Bring some friends together and have conversation, have dialogue about it. And if you can, try to see if you can get enough people to have it hosted as a screening in the town. Now, another good way to spread those good vibes around is, of course, to tell others about this show. Word of mouth and social shares. This is how this comes about. This podcast is funded by patrons. It's funded by you. It's held by you. It is moved around by you. So telling a friend is a really great way to help ATTMind Radio thrive. And if you enjoyed the conversation, chances are you know somebody else who will enjoy it too. If you want to go above and beyond a share and get directly involved with supporting the podcast financially, you can head to jameswjesso.com/support to look at different ways that you can help support the podcast. That includes PayPal, Bitcoin, or Patreon. And if you do become a patron before April 30th and pledge $4 or more, you will get your name printed on the back of a special thank you art card featuring the soon-to-be-revealed new artistic logo designed by visionary artist Eduardo Kine. As always, all relevant links that were mentioned about in the show will be available in the show notes at jameswjesso.com, which is also where you can find links to the support page. It is also where you can find me on social media, usually under the tag James W. Jesso, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook. Connect with me, and I'll connect with you soon. Thanks for listening.